Hello everyone, today we will discuss about the parotid gland part 2. Now first of all, structures within the parotid gland. Okay, there are mainly three. That is the arteries, veins and nerve. From the medial to the lateral side, arteries, veins and nerves. A, V and N. Arteries, veins and nerves from the medial to the lateral side. Now first of all, the arteries. First of all, the artery known as the external carotid artery. The common carotid artery will give external carotid artery, and this external carotid artery will actually enter into the parotid gland from the posteromedial surface. If you remember in my part 1 video of parotid gland, I told you that the external carotid artery actually enters into the gland from the posteromedial surface, and then it will go upward and will give its two terminal branches, that is the maxillary branch and the superficial temporal branch. Now this maxillary branch will actually emerge out of this gland by the enteromedial surface of this gland. But the superficial temporal artery will give its own branch known as the transverse facial branch, and then this superficial temporal artery will emerge out of this gland veins. Now as you can see over here, we have the retromandibular vein. Now this retromandibular vein actually formed by the union of the maxillary vein and the superficial temporal vein. So now this retromandibular vein in the lower part of the gland will divide into anterior and the posterior division. As you can see, anterior and the posterior division, which emerge close to the apex of the gland. Okay, and after this, as you can see over here, the anterior division will unite with the facial vein and will form the common facial vein, and this posterior division, after uniting with the posterior auricular vein, will form the external jugular vein. Okay, now next is the nerves, the lateral part. From medial to lateral, we have artery, vein and nerve. So lateral is the nerves. Now this is the facial nerve. As you can see, if you know that the facial nerve is actually derived from the second brachial arch. Okay, and the facial nerve leaves the skull by passing through the stylomastoid foramen. Now this stylomastoid foramen, if you remember, I told you that the stylomastoid foramen is actually present at the posterior part of the root of the styloid process of the temporal bone. So the facial nerve actually leaves the skull by passing through the stylomastoid foramen of the skull. Now what about after that, what happens in the extracranial course of the facial nerve? After leaving the skull through the stylomastoid foramen, the facial nerve actually crosses the lateral side of the base of the styloid process. It will cross the lateral side of the styloid process, then the nerve enters the posteromedial surface of the parotid gland. Okay, as you can see over, the facial nerve from this posteromedial surface will enter into the gland. From the posteromedial surface, it will run forward through the gland and will actually crosses the two vessels, that means the retromandibular vein and the external carotid artery. As you can see, after entering into the gland, this facial nerve will actually cross the retromandibular vein and the external carotid artery. Now after crossing it, behind the neck of the mandible, as you can see, this is the neck of the mandible. So behind the neck of the mandible, this facial nerve will divide into two main branches of it, that is the temporofacial branch and the cervicofacial branch. Now this temporofacial branch will actually give its further two branches, that is the temporal branch and the zygomatic branch. And the cervicofacial branch will give the buccal, marginal mandibular and the cervical branches. Now these five terminal branches emerge along the anterior border and the apex of the parotid gland. Remember, this all five branches of this temporal branch, zygomatic, upper buccal, lower buccal or the buccal branch, and the mandibular and the cervical branch actually emerge out of this from the anterior border and the apex of the parotid gland. Okay, now the patis fasciovenous plane, this is very important plane. I will tell you why. First of all, what is this? Now as you can see over here, the gland is actually composed of a large superficial and a small deep lobe or part. Okay, and the two being connected by an isthmus. As you can see, this is the isthmus. Okay, and this part is known as the patis fasciovenous plane. Okay, where these two lobes or these two parts of the gland are actually connected with each other. Okay, and over here as you can see, the branch of the facial nerve actually divides over here. Okay, now what is the clinical importance of this patis fasciovenous plane? Is that this plane actually used by the surgeon for doing the surgery of the parotid tumors. The accessory processes of the parotid gland, these are mainly four. This is the first one, the facial process. Facial process along the parotid duct, as you can see, along the parotid duct or the Stenson duct, It lies between the zygomatic arch and the parotid duct. Remember, between the zygomatic arch and the parotid duct. Now, pterygoid process. Pterygoid process is actually present in between the mandibular ramus and the medial pterygoid. As the name says, pterygoid process, so it will be between the mandibular ramus and the medial pterygoid. Then the glenoid process. It is present between the external acoustic meatus and the temporomandibular joint. Okay, external acoustic meatus and the temporomandibular joint. And the last one is the post-stellate process. So we have mainly four processes. There is the glenoid process, facial process, pterygoid process and the post-stellate process. Now the gland is mainly supplied by the external carotid artery and drains into the external jugular vein and the internal jugular vein. Now if you remember, I told you that the external jugular vein is formed when the posterior branch of the retromandibular vein and the posterior auricular vein unites and they will form external jugular vein. Now nerve supply, it is mainly supplied by as parasympathetic, sympathetic and the sensory. Now first of all, parasympathetic nerve are secutor motor and they mainly reach the gland to the auricular temporal nerve. Now look at the diagram. Now the preganglionic fibers of it actually begins in the inferior salivatory nucleus. As you can see, begins at the inferior salivatory nucleus, passes through the glossopharyngeal nerve, this glossopharyngeal nerve, its tympanic branch, also known as the nerve of the Jacobson. Tympanic branch of glossopharyngeal nerve is also known as the nerve of the Jacobson. So from the inferior salivatory nucleus, glossopharyngeal nerve, tympanic branch of the glossopharyngeal nerve, and then passes through the tympanic plexus over here, and then to the lesser petrosal nerve, and relay into the otic ganglion. While the postganglionic fiber passes through the auricular temporal nerve and reaches the gland. Okay, this is the auricular temporal nerve. Passes from the auricular temporal nerve and reaches the gland. So from the inferior salivatory nucleus, glossopharyngeal nerve, tympanic branch of glossopharyngeal nerve or the nerve of Jacobson, tympanic plexus, lesser petrosal nerve, otic ganglion, auricular temporal nerve and then find to the gland are the parasympathetic fibers of this. Also the secretomotor fibers. Sympathetic fibers, they are mainly postganglionic and vasomotor in nature and are derived from the plexus around the middle meningeal artery. Now these fibers mainly starts from the lateral horn of the thoracic one segment of the spinal cord, T1 segment of the spinal cord. Remember, this fiber actually starts from the lateral horn of the T1 segment of the spinal cord and derived from the plexus around the middle meningeal artery. Okay, now the sensory fibers. Sensory fibers or sensory nerves to the gland come from the auriculotemporal nerve, but the parotid fascia and the skin around the fascia and the skin around the gland and the fascia on the gland, they both are mainly innervated by sensory fibers of the greater auricular nerve, that is the C2-C3. Now the lymphatic drainage. Now this parotid gland, okay, actually drains first of all the lymphatic from the parotid nodes and from the upper deep cervical nodes. They actually drain from the parotid nodes and then from the upper deep cervical nodes. Now they mainly drains from the temple, side of scalp, lateral surface of the auricle, external acoustic meatus, middle ear, parotid gland, upper part of the cheek, part of the eyelids and orbit. Now the Stenson's duct or the parotid duct. Now as you can see over here, this is the Stenson's duct. Now this Stenson's duct is thick wall and is about 5 cm long. It emerges from the middle part or the middle of the anterior border of the gland, as you can see. And it runs forward and slightly downward on the masseter muscle. Okay. Now its relations, that is superiorly and inferiorly. Superiorly it is related to mainly three: accessory parotid gland, transverse facial way and the upper buccal branch of the facial nerve. While inferiorly it is related to the lower buccal branch of the facial nerve. Now the anterior border of the masseter muscle, the parotid duct turns medially, as you can see this is the masseter muscle. Okay, and at the anterior border of it, the parotid duct actually turns medially and pierces mainly three things, that is the buccal pad of fat, buccopharyngeal fascia and the buccinator muscle. Remember three things, it pierces mainly three things. Remember over here, as you can see, turns medially from the anterior border of the masseter muscle and mainly pierces three things: buccal pad of fat, buccopharyngeal fascia and the buccinator muscle obliquely. Now because of the oblique nature of the duct over here, so the buccinator muscle, inflation of the duct is mainly prevented during the blowing. When you are blowing, this duct doesn't actually inflate. Why? Because it actually obliquely rotates at the this buccinator muscle, so inflation of it doesn't occur. Now the duct runs forward for a short distance between the buccinator and the oral mucosa. Okay, it will turn, it will run between these two things, buccinator and the oral mucosa, and finally the duct turns medially and opens into the vestibule of the mouth, known as the gingivovestibule. It opens into the gingivovestibule of the mouth. There, you may know what is vestibule, right? Vestibule is the space between your lips and the teeth, is the vestibule of the mouth. Okay, so first of all, it runs in between the oral mucosa and the buccinator muscle, and then finally turns medially and opens into the vestibule known as the gingivovestibule of the mouth. And it is present, it is mainly located opposite the crown of the upper second molar teeth. Its particular location is the gingivovestibule, located opposite the crown of the upper second molar tooth. So this was all about the parotid gland. Just refer my parotid gland video part 1 to know more about this gland. Hope you heard it well. Thank you so much.